Unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and show mercy unto well.
Remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day. 6 days shalt thou labour, and do all that thou hast to do. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt do no manner of work, thou and thy son and thy daughter, thy manservant and thy maidservant, thy cattle, and the stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the seventh day and hallowed it.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Honour thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt do no murder.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not steal.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbour.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not covet thy neighbour's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbour's wife, nor his servant, nor his maid, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is his.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and write all these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee.
Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace that we may cast away the works of darkness and put upon us the armour of light now in the time of this mortal life, in which thy Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the quick and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, now and ever.
Amen.
O Lord Jesus Christ, who at thy first coming didst send thy messenger to prepare thy way before thee, grant that the ministers and stewards of thy mysteries may likewise so prepare and make ready thy way by turning the hearts of the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, that at thy second coming to judge the world, we may be found an acceptable people in thy sight, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
The epistle is written in the fourth chapter of the first letter to the Corinthians, beginning at the first verse. This is how one should regard us, as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. I do not even judge myself. I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then every man will receive his commendation from God. Here endeth the epistle.
The Holy Gospel is written in the 11th chapter of Matthew, beginning at the 2nd verse. Now when John heard in prison about the deeds of the Christ, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you he who is to come, or shall we look for another?" And Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them, and blessed is he who takes no offence at me. As they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. What did you go out into the wilderness to behold? A reed shaken by the wind? Why then did you go out? To see a man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, those who wear soft raiment are in kings' houses. Why then did you go out? To see a prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, who shall prepare thy way before me. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge with the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
To refocus our minds on God.
Judgment can be a difficult part of our faith, I think often because we tend to put judges into two types of people. The first is the judge in a courtroom. They preside over the events of a case, they examine evidence, and they decide whether on the basis of proof someone is guilty or innocent. Of course, if they're innocent, they walk free from the courtroom, but if they're found guilty, they face punishment. But perhaps the second place is where we see judges more commonly, and that's on television. And experts, usually a panel, sit in judgment and they pass comments on the talents, gifts and skills of others. And everything seems to be judged these days. Dancing, baking, sewing, pottery, even sitting in a Welsh castle, or people sitting on an island just by being in a couple. There's nothing that a person can do that doesn't seem to make for a good judging on TV. And have you noticed how we are often encouraged to partake in this judging? Pick up the phone, vote someone in, vote someone out. It's worth remembering that in both cases, those involved may feel shame, embarrassment, or even fear. And the greater risk is that we might take that image of judging into our relationship with God. When we say in the Creed that Jesus shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, it is easy to turn Jesus into the sort of judge who will come into the courtroom already wearing the black cap, ready to condemn us. And partly this feeling is based on the fact that we know we are far from perfect. We are a long way from what God intended for us. As the General Confession in the Book of Common Prayer puts it, there is no health in us. And that means we know that we need God's mercy, and that in response to his love and forgiveness, we need to shape our lives to be servants of Christ. Well, in this third week of Advent, what might that look for us? Could the words Jesus sent to John the Baptist give us a prompt to how we could look at our individual and corporate behaviour so that we might reflect upon it and alter it? To what are we spiritually and morally blind? As our society, where do we shut our eyes to injustice? What are the things we just ignore or turn our gaze from? That means, what are the key issues of poverty and injustice in our time? For example, COVID vaccine inequality. Why do some countries struggle to access vaccines whilst wealthy countries are able to stockpile them? It means not only are variants more likely to occur, but the biggest health impacts will always be in the countries with poorer healthcare systems. What is our responsibility here? How can I challenge it or change it? Well, I know I can't heal people like Jesus, but I certainly can make a donation to vaccine aid. Next, to what are we deaf? Are there people crying out in pain or fear, and we simply turn the volume down on them so that they don't disturb us? The refugee crisis immediately springs to mind, that people are willing to drown in the Channel rather than stay in the migrant camps in France. And don't forget the silent cries of pain from our planet as it is abused and polluted. The climate change crisis impacts our lives right now, and of course the greatest impact is once again seen on the poorest countries. Individually and corporately, how much responsibility do we take for the rubbish we produce? I encourage you to think about your choice of Christmas cards and wrapping paper, to choose ones that are recyclable and reuse where you can. And thirdly, where are we spiritually lame or mute? When do we not act when we should? Are there issues of abuse or bullying going on in our very communities that we should be speaking up about? And by that I mean not only individuals, but also businesses and government departments and policies. Because here's the good only way to truly transform ourselves is through the repentance that John the Baptist preached, that by turning back to God and asking for the Holy Spirit to strengthen us to do always what is right, that is, to live in Christ, that we may be found acceptable in the sight of God. Amen. Whatsoever ye would that men should do unto you, even so do unto them, for this is the law and the prophets. Let us pray for the whole state of Christchurch militants here in England. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the Spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also to save and defend all Christian kings, princes, and governors, especially thy servant Elizabeth, our queen, that under her we may be godly and quietly governed. And grant unto her whole counsel, and to all that have put in authority under her, that they may truly and indifferently minister justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and curates, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace. Our notices for this Sunday, later on today at 6 o'clock, there will be carols in the square outside St Margaret's in West Hoathly, 6 o'clock. And on the 15th of December, that's Wednesday, we have our third Advent reflection. That's also at St Margaret's this week. Next Sunday, the fourth Sunday of Advent, there will be 9 o'clock matins here at All Saints. And at 6 o'clock in the evening, there will be carols by candlelight, also here at Highbrook. You will notice that there's a lot again, so do take home your sermon sheet and look through the notices. In particular, please note that our ARC intention, our intention to do acts of random kindness, will draw to a close at the end of this year. So please do take home a sticker or two and use every opportunity in these last few weeks to do an act of kindness to someone you know. Churchwardens, any notices? No? Well, I invite you to stand for the blessing, and then we will sing our final hymn on Jordan's Bank, number 27.